Hello, and welcome to this week's Movie Math, where you might recall a Comic-Con ago, Luc Besson was talking smack about Christopher Nolan as they were set to go up against each other the same weekend at the box office. Well, fast forward a year later, and it looks like Luc Besson jinxed himself. Now, you might think because he talked about it at Comic-Con and bragged about it, but the reality is because he cast horrible leads. In all the discussion about Valerian's box office this weekend, I haven't seen a single person talk about the fact that it starred Dane DeHaan and Cara Delevingne, which seems to me like the obvious reason that it didn't work out. I think that was obvious from the get-go. As soon as we saw the trailers, everyone's reaction was, "That sure looks pretty. Too bad Dane DeHaan and Cara Delevingne are smack in the middle of it." And I think that even though I didn't get a chance to see the movie, I apologize, I was traveling and I missed the press screenings, I am still 1,000,000,000% positive. That's right, billion with a B, percent positive, that with two different actors, I would even dare say any two other actors, but ideally more commercial ones with at least decent box office track records, and the movie would have opened better, right? Exact same script, exact same ad campaign, just put in different faces. At this point, I don't think that any movie that wants to make money should cast Dane DeHaan or Cara Delevingne. And I know that's going to make some of you sad, but imagine how sad the producers and studios are behind movies that with them in it that lose hundreds of millions of dollars. And we are talking about hundreds of millions when it comes to Valerian. But it looks like Warner Brothers is going to make money yet again off of Christopher Nolan, and Universal is definitely making money off of Girls Trip. But let's start with the number one movie of the weekend, and that is Dunkirk. Dun dun dun, nobody doubted it would happen. They tried to inject some drama in the trades, like on Thursday, being like, "We're only projecting 30 to 40 million. Oh, it's overperforming." Last week on a Movie Math, we pegged it at 50, which is exactly where it opened, right? So I thought that was interesting, and I wonder if Warner Brothers had anything to do with that. They're like, "Could you say that it was supposed to open lower than it was, so that it looks really like it's doing amazing? I mean, it's doing very well, but it's not overperforming." But I would say that Nolan has found his non-Batman sweet spot, because Dunkirk opened right in between Inception and Interstellar. So any studio that wants to work with him in the future, this is where you should expect him to open. Except with Bond, and we'll talk about that for sure. Now those films, though, Inception and Interstellar, are more high concept, right? They're popcorn. Well, they're cerebral popcorn movies, but popcorn movies nonetheless. Don't expect this World War II movie to catch up to them globally. And that's totally fine. I mean, domestically, the highest grossing World War II movie is Saving Private Ryan, which Dunkirk should easily be able to top. We don't adjust for inflation, that's just the way it is, or no movie would ever beat Gone with the Wind or Sound of Music, etc. That's the real reason they don't adjust for inflation. They'd be like, "Damn, nobody goes to the movies compared to, you know, the Great Depression, when, you know, there was nothing else to do." But anyway, and you could go for a can of soup. This would also mean, though, that 2017 would give us the top earning films of all time for both World Wars, which I think is a fun little trivia fact. But first, Nolan has to actually do it. I think he will. I also think that the Nolan fan base, the ability that they have to support his films is so impressive that that should make him even more attractive to Barbara Broccoli. But who are we kidding? She definitely wants him, right? She definitely wants him. Meetings have been taken, not just set. And so I'm sure they'll reach a deal pretty soon, because Daniel Craig, of course, is locked up. Dunkirk, though, will get his price up, you know, his not only his salary, his upfront salary, but perhaps gross participation. And also it'll lead to him getting more creative control, which I think could have been debatable after Interstellar. Not that he wouldn't have some creative control, but, you know, final edit, I'd be like, I don't know. Because, you know, Interstellar didn't do as well as Inception, and it was expected to. And he was given carte blanche for Interstellar as a result of, you know, the Batman movies and Inception. And when it didn't perform to the same heights, I think Hollywood, like, kind of took a step back from Nolan. But I think now with the reviews, a strong opening for this type of movie, I think he's basically back. And if I were his management team or his wife/producer, Emma Thomas, I would say take Bond, give yourself another blockbuster, you know, another Batman type movie. So, you know, you get a second wind and you can go back to making the more cerebral films that you enjoy so much. Now, speaking of upping your price tag, I'm sure Universal is glad they signed Malcolm D. Lee's first look deal before Girls Trip opened, because that truly overperformed. It was supposed to open around 20, opened at 30. That's three times the box office debut of the white version of the movie. That's absolutely spectacular. And not only is it great for Malcolm D. Lee, the whole cast is getting accolades, but I want to give a shout out to Jada Pinkett Smith, because when she was on Gotham, I think a lot of people just said it was stunt casting, but she did a lot of heavy lifting when she was on the show, so much so that they brought her back for a little bit in season three, because she's an all-star player, at least on that show. But with this success, she suddenly has a comeback. That's very, very exciting for her. Because I think she's always been the weakest member of the Smith family, right? When it, you know, and I'm even including her kids in that. I also think that diversification is serving Universal quite well, first with Get Out and now this. And you'll probably, you should expect to see the studio head even further in that direction now. But Dunkirk and Girls Trip aren't golden just yet, because this summer the big question is, yeah, you open nicely, but what's your hold? Because only Wonder Woman has a good answer to that so far, and she has become the biggest domestic earner of the summer after 8 weekends, having just surpassed Guardians of the Galaxy. We're going to see if she can get to Volume 2. We'll see if she can get to $800 million worldwide, but she's still about $100 million behind Batman v Superman. But she's the top earner in the DCEU domestically, and she is now the second highest earner worldwide. That's a really big deal, especially considering that she is a... she's a female superhero. That's just so spectacular. I'd also like to say, though, that, you know, it's still not easy for her, because I was disappointed to see one of the trades refer to her as a metal bikini-clad superhero. I was like, wow, really? I think they changed that costume enough that that's no longer what she is. But anyway, as for these drops, I'm sorry to say, War for the Planet of the Apes, so many of you defended that movie so strongly, but it's just not captivating audiences, as I kind of predicted. And it fell 64% in its second weekend, 14% more than the two previous installments in the franchise. And Spider-Man Homecoming tumbled another 50% in its third weekend, which means it could end up being one of the lowest earners for the web swinger. That's so bad. Marvel's like, distancing myself from this. I guess they got what they wanted. He's going to be in Infinity War, but that's not great. Then, only the smaller flicks in the top 10 are enjoying Wonder Woman type holds, and by that I mean drops just in the 30s. But luckily for Dunkirk and Girls Trip and everyone in the top 10, the new entries this coming weekend are only moderate competitors. Get this! Atomic Blonde might come in behind the Emoji movie, which solicits a cringe emoji for Charlize Theron and her team. Although director David Leitch is just fine, because he's already in the middle of directing Deadpool 2. But if that doesn't work out, oh boy, that's going to be really bad. Then, you know, but we'll see. You know, things can change. We've seen a lot of tracking shift at the last minute, but that is quite the surprise. What movie did you see this past weekend? What movie are you planning to see this coming weekend? Share your thoughts down below about the box office, and I'll be looking for your most clever ones. And I will select one BTC subscriber's comment. You have to be a subscriber to qualify to win Beyond the Trailer's Movie a Day giveaway. This is happening through August 18th, and every weekday, I pick a comment from a BTT subscriber on one of the videos of the day to get the AMC gift card. Make sure you turn on your subscriptions so I can see them on your page. A number of you would have won, but did not, because when I go to your page, I can't see who you're subscribed to. So if you're wondering if that's the case, log off, go to your page, and see if you can see your subscriptions. All right, that's today's Movie Math. Thank you so much for going over the box office with me. I look forward to your comments down below. It doesn't have to be clever. It could be cute. It could be fun. It just has to, you know, get my attention. And it has to be about the video, not me. But thank you so much, and you can check out some more videos right now.